and I quote, "With specific reference to the Hall of Fame page, I state that it has never been the intent to out any person, living or dead, who is not already credited by history or directly by themselves as being of homosexual, bisexual orientation. In the case of Rudolph Valentino, I greatly appreciate the research work you have carried out, in particular the interview with the author, an acknowledgement that he had not a single fact to back up the claims in their book, and I value the fact that you have kindly informed me of such. Bottom line, I do care about historical accuracy, and consequently, the name Rudolph Valentino has been removed from the Gay Hall of Fame page, and again, may I thank you for your words of clarification. Sincerely appreciated." End quote. The preceding is the text of an email sent to me by Mr. David Hall of the Gay Tyneside Hall of Fame, which I received sometime around 2003. I still consider this message valuable, as it demonstrates an honorable respect for the historical data credited to Valentino, as well as for his own statements as being the two sources required for making a claim about his sexual orientation. Now, unfortunately, Mr. David Hall's impressive integrity and, quote, interest in historical accuracy, end quote, seems to be an exception in this regard today. And I am once again called upon to address those attempting to force and exploit an outing of Rudolph Valentino, despite the continued and complete absence of historical data and in the absence of any personal statement to this by Rudolph Valentino himself. I advise in advance of this episode that there will be some adult language, and I add that this is not my language, but I feel sharing it to be necessary to set the record straight about those who have ravaged the truth about Rudolph Valentino in exposing them and their fictionalization based on gossipy fantasies. We present this episode today, which we have titled Rudolph Valentino, Homophobia, and More.
Ciao, I am Renato Floris, the publisher of all the scholarly, entertaining, and documented books on Rudolph Valentino and Natasha Rambova by Evelyn Zumaya. I'm here today with Evelyn to discuss more about her fascinating work. Ciao, Evelyn.
Ciao, Renato. Well, this subject is one I've had to address over and over for the past 10 years. But I feel once again I must make one point very clear, very clear. Rudolph Valentino was not gay and not bisexual. Wow, how dare I say such a thing? Surely I will be accused for saying that of being homophobic. But, oh wait, I already have been, and maybe 1,000 times or even more. Now, of course, in the past, in discussing this subject, I have been accused of being homophobic, but nothing could be further from the truth. I am not homophobic, never have been, and never could be. But perhaps there's a freedom for me in having been called homophobic erroneously so many times. I'm not about to be surprised when I'm called homophobic again for this episode. But you know, Renato, you know, no matter how many times I'm called homophobic for saying there is no historical evidence that Rudolph Valentino was gay, it will never make me homophobic. Just as it makes no difference how many times these determined few say Valentino was gay, it will not change history and make him so. So, Renato, I proceed today by using the criteria set forth by David Hall in his email to me, and use as a format for this discussion the existing historical criteria and Valentino's personal statements. But I begin by sharing a bit of my own history on this subject. I think it was sometime in 2003 when my then literary agent suggested I put my work on Affairs Valentino on hold to research Valentino's sexual orientation. He explained how every time he mentioned he represented an author writing a biography on the man, the first question asked was, wasn't he gay? I told him I felt the entire subject was too volatile to touch. But he argued it would be impossible for me not to have an intelligent answer. So I rather reluctantly agreed to take some time and see what I could find out. What was the basis for those rumors Rudolph Valentino was gay? Now, when I felt my research was complete and I had my answer, I wrote an article I titled Words of Clarification. I shared the article with my friend, Natasha Rembova scholar Michael Morris, and Valentino memorabilia collector Bill Self. They both supported my researching the subject and agreed to proof my work. Now, unbeknownst to me, Michael Morris submitted the article to the University of Turin Scientific Committee, then organizing a world conference on Valentino. They accepted the paper and my research and sent me an invitation to read a shortened version of the article at the conference. And well, I will say I had no idea at the time, of course, but in accepting the invitation, my life would be changed forever. And that's putting it mildly, wouldn't you say?
Not only yours, believe me, not only yours.
Now, I would present a 30-minute speech titled Gay, Bi, or Straight, a comprehensive and historical analysis of Rudolph Valentino's sexual orientation based on newly discovered documents, which I delivered in the Reader's Club here in Turin, sharing my discoveries as to how Valentino was made gay by the means of a few highly fictionalized books, which were passed off as being nonfiction by unscrupulous and enterprising authors. By the way, a video of that speech is online and can be linked to and watched through affairsvalentino.com. Now, in that speech, I cited several publications, tracing the Valentino was gay rumors back to their earliest origins. I set out to connect the dots, I guess you could say, and in the course of presenting this aspect of Valentino's history, I spent some 5 minutes vetting a book titled Dream of Desire by David Brett. From that day forward, I would be labeled homophobic, accused of, and I quote, starting it all. And I would be bullied mercilessly ever since. I would be forced to sue David Brett for defamation, a case I won, which is still working its way through international legal process. As a result of that speech, the internet would be flooded with insane lies about my appearance in the Reader's Club, claims I was yanked from the podium for my homophobic comments, claims the audience booed and hissed at me throughout. And yes, there was even one report posted that I was arrested after the speech for sexually assaulting a woman in the ladies' room. And as you know, there were even more disgusting allegations made, which were far worse. But in that speech, I did not say Valentino was gay, bisexual, or straight. I instead wove together those literary anecdotes which were passed from fiction writer to fiction writer unimpeded as they gathered speed in coming to be believed as fact. Of course, I have since expanded my research and learned even more. And I would, if I could go back in time and have the opportunity to give that speech again, I would state the obvious. I would be braver. I think my hesitation was understandable then. It's an odd thing to in someone historically. And my apprehensions about even touching the subject were wildly justified. Today, I will present my definitive conclusion, which I did not in 2009, and do so based on my broader analysis of the legitimate history credited to Valentino, as documented throughout the past decade since his death, and on the direct statements made by Valentino in his personal correspondence, some of which was recently made public. Today, after 20 years of research on the subject, I state definitively that Rudolph Valentino was not gay and not bisexual. You know, Renato, truthfully, if I knew what would happen to me as a result of my delivering that speech for even touching the subject, I'm not sure I would have even shown up at all. But that's not how fate had this story unfold. And since I met you that week at the Valentino conference, of course, I have no regrets, not a single one.
You did a great job on that article and really addressed some historical points which I noticed people attacking you at twisted into fiction.
I did, Renato, and before we go any further, I think I need to mention how this very subject was used to bully Valentino during his lifetime. I will be reading excerpts from the article I wrote today, which, by the way, is also posted in its entirety on the affairsvalentino.com website. So in reference to some of the origins of this subject in general, I excerpt words of clarification, and I quote, Rudolph Valentino's predicament was further exacerbated by the cultural disparities between his homeland in Italy, where men commonly wore colored shirts and jewelry as a sign of style and success, and in America in 1921, where it was not acceptable for men to look too fashionable. In keeping with his heritage, Valentino demonstrated his success by wearing chain bracelets, a wristwatch, colored shirts and ties. However, the predominantly white Anglo-Saxon male establishment at the time adamantly held that beauty in America had but one gender, and that was feminine. This presented Valentino's critics with fodder to deter his influence over young people. What more effective way, they reasoned, to discourage emulating the chic than to associate him with every stereotype they could devise? They asserted Valentino paid too much attention to his well-appreciated beauty and was therefore held responsible for an unmanly trend in young men's fashions. The implication was made that one's sexuality is defined by their clothes and fastidiousness, and this became a key component of the anti-Valentino movement. He was mocked as a dandy, a pansy, less than manly, weak-willed, effeminate. These were all code words for homosexuality. At the time, even the meekest quip about a man's flamboyant style of dress generated reactions. As Valentino rose to fame, headlines reading Valentino, movie hero of the Vaselined hair, and Valentino, model for effeminate lads, is here, incensed his fans and laid the groundwork for decades of insinuation, end quote. Now, Valentino's legacy has subsequently been ravaged by that innuendo generated by several dominant topics referencing his sexual orientation. The anonymously written Pink Powder Puff editorial in the Chicago Tribune, accusing him of being effeminate and of being an effeminate influence on American men, and the complications of his two marriages. Now, we've discussed the ramifications of the innuendo and fictionalization of these aspects of Valentino's life in greater detail in some of our previous episodes.
After Valentino's death, authors began to exploit his sex appeal to sell all sorts of shady books.
Oh, they did. And the preferred format for these pulp fiction books was what I call the faux diaries, the fake diaries written in the first person, as if Valentino was the author. Now, in my article, Words of Clarification, I explain this in some detail, but for today's purposes, I will excerpt the following, and I quote, "The resulting fictional diaries of Valentino became little more than pornography and are often referred to today as Valentino's unpublished diaries. None of them were credible, unpublished, or Valentino's. The earliest to profit from this diary format was smut peddler Samuel Roth. 5 years after Valentino's death, he published his intimate journal of Rudolph Valentino. Known for his literary pirating practices, Samuel Roth published primarily adult reading material. Other titles released around the same time as his Intimate Journal of Rudolph Valentino were titled Padlocks and Girdles of Chastity, Sacred Prostitution and Marriage by Capture, Venus and Furs, Self-Amusement and Its Specters, and The Secret Places of the Human Body. Now, Roth wrote his Intimate Journal of Rudolph Valentino in the first person and formatted the text as if they were Valentino's daily entries, such as this entry. The thoughts which seed through my mind tonight are of so violent and horrible a nature that I will not trust names even to this secret journal of mine. Another entry. I was completely exhausted and raging mad. For 3 hours I had made frantic love to the stubborn wench, and for 3 hours she resisted me. Now, Roth's diary would be the inspiration for another infamous variation on the theme of Valentino's alleged sexual escapades. Some 30 years after Samuel Roth's effort, another diary attributed to Valentino appeared as an anonymous article in the French language magazine La Presse. This was in the February 27, 1961 issue. This article would be the first publication in which Valentino was portrayed as being homosexual. Now, in Jean de Recqueville's biography, Rudolph Valentino, she meticulously discredits the La Presse diary. She challenged the article's anonymous author to produce a single page of the diary, which was allegedly handwritten by Valentino. She reprinted a letter in Valentino's handwriting in her biography for use as comparison by a handwriting expert willing to make a professional authentication of the La Presse piece. Her challenge was never met, end quote. Now, two of the most notorious profiteers exploiting Rudolph Valentino's sex life were the authors of the book Rudolph Valentino, An Intimate and Shocking Exposé by Chomank and Brad Steiger. And on this, I excerpt again words of clarification. And I quote, during the 1920s, Chomank was publisher and sole employee of his bimonthly Movie Fans newsletter and organized fan clubs for some 50 celebrities. He regularly mailed those stars questionnaires along with requests for one of their personal Christmas cards to reprint in his newsletter. Most of Mank's celebrities, including Rudolph Valentino, did respond to his fan club questionnaires and sent along friendly letters and photographs for use in his publication. Mank's claim that these celebrities ever divulged anything of a graphically sexual nature to him is really questionable. With his ability to relay anything they divulged to him to his fan clubs via the newsletter, he would have been the last person they would have confided in. Nevertheless, Mank asserts Rudolph Valentino did just that. Chomank was a man of diverse interests, and one of his other fields of endeavor was to hand-stitch the many celebrity autographed patches of cloth he collected into celebrity quilts. He was also an avid collector of country music star autographs and wrote a few country western songs, including I Don't Want a Bracelet of Diamonds, I Just Want Elvis. Now, in 1965, he collaborated with author and self-proclaimed authority on unidentified flying objects and alien abductions, Brad Steiger, to write The Intimate and Shocking Exposé of Rudolph Valentino. A few other titles attributed to Mank's co-author Brad Steiger are Flying Saucer Invasion Target Earth, Flying Saucers Are Hostile, Strangers from Skies, and The Flying Saucer Menace. Now, Brad Steiger also touts his expertise in the field of demonic possession, and he reveals his belief that he has been contacted by a race of extraterrestrials who live in underground bases buried under the sea. But in suburban Illinois in the early 60s, Brad Steiger met and collaborated with Chomank on their shocking expose of Rudolph Valentino. Their sensational novel is chock full of X-rated reference and is, in their own words, the shocking expose of the fiery love god Rudolph Valentino. They portrayed their subject as a sexually confused man who fumbled helplessly through one homosexual and heterosexual situation after another while spending his days living a life of debauchery in the gay bathhouses of Hollywood. Now, while writing their exposé, Mank and Steiger were so invested in obscenity that in the 192 pages of this book, there are some 80 overt sexual references and scenarios. The book's sexual content is such that today it is archived in the Rare Manuscripts Department in Cornell University's Kroc Library under Human Sexuality. Now, Mank and Steiger include a poignant quote in the book from Valentino in which he laments that he's misunderstood. Then they proceed to contribute to the situation. They crawl over Valentino's person with discussions of his genitalia, his pubic hair, and whether he's able to have an erection. They repeat and elaborate upon the myth of his unconsummated marriages, and the familiar refrain of his lesbian wives is played once again for old time's sake. They portray Valentino as so emotionally frail that he trembles in fear in Natasha Rumbova's presence. Now, in the foreword of Mankensteiger's shocking expose, the following quote is found, and I quote, "One never knows when a harmless bit of exaggeration may someday return to require the substantiation of an outright lie." The irony of this statement would be sorely felt by Brad Steiger when I located him and asked him a few questions regarding his work on Valentino. When asked to substantiate some of his apparent exaggerations, he said that the book was based upon, and I quote, Chaw Manx's own memories. One of Manx's memories, he claimed, was that Valentino's marriage to Natasha Rumbova was a platonic one of convenience, and I quote Brad Steiger, Valentino's two wives were lesbians, and Nazimova, who had a great influence upon their lives, was an outspoken lesbian. These apparent facts strongly suggest that the marriage was arranged, end quote. Shuddering at this flawless distillation of 80 years of misinformation, I asked Brad Steiger how he could possibly make such assumptions. He told me that he and Manx assumed Valentino was gay or bisexual because Valentino's first wife, Jean Acker, was a lesbian. He continued by explaining that they formed this belief because Valentino and Jean Acker divorced, and I quote Brad Steiger, on grounds of non-consummation when he wished to marry Ms. Rumbova, which seems suggestive of and supportive of the allegations of homosexuality, end quote. Now, I had to remind Mr. Steiger that sexual orientation is not contagious, and Valentino having gay friends and associates and even a gay wife, Jean Acker, did not impact his sexual orientation in the slightest way.
So, this brings you to the subject of David Brett and his book Dream of Desire, in which I do know it is claimed Rudolph Valentino had love affairs with almost every man in his life. I think he mentioned something like 20 or 30 men.
Yes, and again, from words of clarification, and I quote, Brett held Chaw Manx to be the definitive word on Valentino by quoting him repeatedly and implying that they shared a personal correspondence during the writing of his book. This is unlikely, as Chaw Manx died in 1985, 13 years earlier. He uses line-by-line parallels from Manx's book, such as Chaw Manx's Bob, the husky young escort, becomes Brett's Rob, the hunky young escort. Brett's inclusion of specific scenarios and his listing of the unpublished diaries of Rudolph Valentino reveal that one of his prime sources was the fictitious and anonymously written La Presse article. By relying on third and fourth hand hearsay information, which he presents as fact, Brett claims an intimate knowledge of Valentino's sleeping arrangement and portrays his subject as sadomasochistic and sexually insatiable. Brett also asserts that virtually every single one of Valentino's male friends and acquaintances, business or personal, totaling some 35 men, were all his gay lovers. Brett's list of Valentino's gay lovers includes everyone, from his manager George Ullman to his handyman Lou Mahoney to movie censorship czar Will Hayes. Now, A Dream of Desire's bibliography consists of 12 books and various unpublished works with no information as to where a reader might access these references. These unpublished works include Rudolph Valentino's unpublished diaries, 1923 to 1926, end quote. So the history of the claim that Valentino led his life as a closeted homosexual was born in homophobia and given renewed life around the mid-1960s and on in some of the most brazen fiction ever written about Valentino. And I cite Jean de Recqueville for her comment on this from her book, where she says, and I quote, homosexuality in Valentino is a relatively recent insinuation. It is used because it has been discovered that homosexuality in general sells very well, and related to Valentino, it sells even better than any other. So this was some of what I discovered, some of it, while conducting my research in my quest for that definitive answer. Not only was Rudolph Valentino not gay and not bisexual, the very premise was a fictional invention which constituted a continuation of the homophobic abuse hurled his way before his untimely death. I believe Brett, as he published Dream of Desire, around the time social media was born, well, he has had the greatest impact on this. And in my opinion, he exploits and appropriates the subject of homosexuality and homophobia to titillate and sensationalize his Rudolph Valentino book, and he does so with no documentation brought forth. I've asked him for years to produce any documentation for his wild and prurient claims, which of course he cannot. In only one instance, he did attempt to pass something off as documentation. In his response to my request for that secret unpublished diary in which he claims Valentino divulges his homosexuality, Brett cited a book published here in Italy, edited by Paolo Orlandelli. I had to laugh, actually, because Mr. Orlandelli gave his speech the same day as I did at the Valentino conference, and that diary, it is his translation into Italian of Valentino's My Private Diary. It's ridiculous. I think this brings us to the why of today's episode. Today there is a situation in the Rudolph Valentino world. A tenet that Rudolph Valentino is gay or bisexual is enforced as dogma in the repressive world of Valentino Facebook forums, which are primarily run by and under the control of David Brett, Simon Constable, and Tracy Terhune. These three men continue in their public alliance to inflict the legacy of Valentino with their intellectually dishonest works, while ruthlessly imposing their propaganda on the followers of their various Facebook forums. I've been told many times by members of those forums that questioning whether Valentino was gay often and almost always results in their comments being deleted from the said forum. The only way some of these folks feel it is possible to maintain a presence or even a membership on those forums is to say nothing or to pander to them by saying perhaps Valentino was bisexual. Now, Emily Leiter, in her Valentino biography, Dark Lover, wrote, quote, "Bisexuality is always an option," end quote, and left the subject there. But in my opinion, that is pandering. For it is surmise, because most anything is an option, even murder, I guess. David Brett, Simon Constable, and Tracy Terhune polish their public images and pat each other on the back, all while they load the internet with outrageous fiction and surmise and flood cyberspace with their false narrative, which is so passionately presented, it is assumed to be true by many. I think it is important to recognize certain phrases they use today, such as those same phrases used by Brad Steiger, which I just read, such as, quote, "certainly implies," or "this would seem to be true." That is not fact, but implication and opinion.
They had called you homophobic for even talking about this, and they know your life story and know this is such a false statement.
It sure is, Renato. And you know, as far back as 2003, I was receiving emails from people, those I call the Valentino disenfranchised, because they dared to say they did not believe Valentino was gay and ask for some documentation for this. And they received terrible treatment. Everything from being deleted from a chat room or a forum to being mocked, criticized, and yes, being called homophobic. This is not a new thing. But the continuing entrenched tyranny of this is really offensive to me. You would think over the past decades they would have become more enlightened about homophobia, about forcing the outing of someone based on lies, about using this to bully. There has been so much welcome awareness of these things recently, and I think they completely missed that. I think this situation in the Rudolph Valentino world exists some because it is important to David Brett, Simon Constable, and Tracy Terhune to maintain this version of Valentino, because it sells books. And I know they have literally constructed their very identity in the Valentino world, not only writing on their pricey personal Valentino collections, but based on their adherence to the belief that Valentino was gay. And I will add, basically saying that all of his friends and wives were too. Now, furthering this historical travesty, they have reconstructed Valentino's life story around the premise which includes the absurd statement that Valentino's marriage to Rumbova was a lavender one. Everything from small events in Valentino's life, such as a fishing trip with a friend, to the account of his evening spent with the showgirl Marion Benda on the night he fell so critically ill. They seize on any event as an opportunity to contort the facts into their absurdly twisted version of it all, so it supports the Valentino was gay theory and their years-long outing based on nothing. I personally find outing someone else offensive and cruel. Is it not a deeply personal decision and the timing so critical in a person's life that to forcibly out someone, living or dead, famous or not famous, and based on innuendo? In my opinion, it's just wicked. David Brett does that for a living. And if someone protests or criticizes him, he begins his chant. The only good homophobe is a dead one. Posting this as his catchy tagline in an even redder red and a bolder bold. What BS. This while praising himself for his alleged noble efforts in outing another dead celebrity and inflating his role as hero. While he has claimed for years that he is a champion of routing out homophobia, when in fact, and I state as fact, he does so by issuing some of the most divisive, homophobic, and hateful anti-gay rhetoric I have ever read, and all while perpetuating depraved and antiquated gay stereotypes. This is especially so concerning his insanely misogynistic attacks on women. How can he call himself a champion of the LGBT plus community when he uses the term lesbian to defame, calling me a litany of misogynistic anti-lesbian insults, such as luckless lesbian cow, raving lesbian no man would have. And I cite a quote here from a new book I'm working on, and I quote, again, as Brett touted himself as champion of gay rights and against cyberbullies, he used the word lesbian to demean, revealing his arch homophobic attitudes against lesbians by writing that I was a, quote, lesbian retard, raving lesbian, sapphic meathead, pussy grabber, and lesbian arslicker. He also wrote extensively that I was a closeted lesbian abusing young girls, posting that I was a, quote, virtually unknown extant of the Hollywood fringe sapphic circles, a minge muncher, and fingering fish boxes, end quote. You know, Renato, I think of it this way. What if in the future, say 50 years or so from now, someone thinks it's a spectacular idea to write a sensational biography of Elton John? Instead of making it a true account of this great gay icon's life, the author claims they have secret documentation proving Elton John was actually a heterosexual who had a secret wife and many women as secret lovers, claiming that almost every woman he knew was his secret lover. What if this author made a laborious case by tracking the Rocket Man's travels and made a huge deal of how he was often seen in the company of known heterosexual females, and that this certainly would imply he was a heterosexual? How ridiculous this would be. Why, I ask, why is this scenario in its converse reality so 100% reviled and opposed? What if this author claimed that Elton John's husband, David Furnish, was actually just a beard, someone Elton John married to cover up for his heterosexuality? What kind of absurdity would that be? To twist the honest life and love of Elton John, to deny his credibility and established history and personal statements just to sell books? And what if this author gained popularity by writing his book as porn fiction and then further promoted his absurdity by going online and writing extensively about Elton John's straight secret life and loves? What if this author claimed they knew far more than anyone in Elton John's personal life? Well, what BS. And, well, that is exactly what happened to Rudolph Valentino.
I know you have many emails and letters from people who feel the same as you do about this.
I do. And I do know that this issue has divided the Valentino world, and not in a good way at all. And I add here that the accusation I have some agenda in this other than to speak up against it is sickening. Out of the some 500 pages in Affairs Valentino, I devote but 5 pages to the subject. And I do not consider this anything to make the focus of Valentino's life, but oh brother, they sure do. David Brett, writing book after book about Rudolph Valentino being the, quote, man who loved only men. He has one theme, and that is it. I have no agenda other than to share my research on this. Now, I've told my personal history before, and I do not have to defend myself in this regard. My life stands as testimony. Long before the sitcom Will and Grace ever aired, I lived that reality. With my 2 dear gay roommates who helped me as a single mom parenting my sons. Now, when David Brett learned about that, he said I took advantage of my friends, and I only lived with them to hide my homophobia. Really desperate of him. That he then impugned my friend and roommate Roger, who died of AIDS, by calling him Randy Roger. And despite our little family suffering the loss of Roger to the disease, Brett crowed on and on that I was a gay plague for which there was no cure, saying I was far more contagious than AIDS. Now, I believe you do not force a sexual orientation on anyone, ever, and you do not use the subject of AIDS, homophobia, and gay bashing as a tool to bully. Yet this has been done, and yes, I was even accused of advocating gay bashing. I cite as a response to that a small book I wrote with a friend of mine, Wayne Walker, titled Buddha's Tooth and Morphine. I wrote this book under an alias, Lord Wild, to hide it from David Brett. It is the story of a real gay bashing my friend Wayne, who is a homosexual, experienced and his subsequent recovery or complete lack thereof. Now, David Brett did discover the book, and he seized that opportunity to write one of his evil spoof books about Wayne, perpetuating horrendous gay stereotypes, saying Wayne went to Sri Lanka to not find a cure, which he did, but to act as a pedophile and a child abuser. That is homophobic. And when my friend and Rombova scholar Michael Morris defended me, David Brett began to call him Padre Liberace. All of this is such a high degree of homophobic rhetoric. So I make the connection between the homophobic insinuations inflicted on Rudolph Valentino, and which caused him so much distress during his short life, to what is now being wielded by the alliance of David Brett, Simon Constable, and Tracy Terhune. Rudolph Valentino's truth has been and still is ravaged in this way by these homophobic zealots, while the actual history credited to Valentino, which stands as his truth, has not been forgotten. Now, I brought forth this story, and I've paid dearly for it, but now I want to turn the direction of this episode to emphasize that actual history credited to verify Valentino's true sexual orientation. And I say that this stands as an impressive body of knowledge. And I qualify this, Renato, by saying that my citations today are by far not all of the factual accounts and data. For today, regarding the body of actual history in existence verifying Rudolph Valentino's heterosexuality, I cite the following. Rudolph Valentino's own admission to having sex with women, walking prostitutes, as they were called, as a teenager, and his contracting a venereal disease in the process, as Alberto Valentino told collector Bill Self and as Self told me. Also, this is revealed in a letter Valentino wrote to his friend Bruno, in which he references the same. And as an aside, I say this letter is now in the hands of Tracy Terhune, but it should be available to researchers. So moving on here, Valentino's propensity for falling in love and is specifically spending his time with showgirls at the local theater. And I cite Alberto Valentino's interview with Italo Americana about this. And I quote, Alberto says, Rudolfo had the devil in his makeup. Among his friends, he was the ringleader, daring to do anything, especially when it concerned pretty girls. One time on a bet, he stretched a rope between 2 adjoining balconies, 15 feet above the ground, and walked his tightrope from one balcony to the other. He was a natural-born acrobat and afraid of nothing. My mother nearly fainted when she saw him tottering on the tightrope, arms stretched. He, undaunted and smiling, flushed with triumph, descended from the balcony, and taking the arms of 2 pretty girls who'd stood underneath watching, bore them off in triumph. He was then 12 years old. At 17, I can't tell you how many girls flirted with him, and he in turn with them. And in an interview with Alberto, as conducted by Jean Valentino, Alberto is asked to comment on the allegations that Rudolph was a homosexual. He responded by saying, quote, "Those are all complete lies," end quote. And in the Gazzetta del Mezzogiorno, on the January 23rd, 1989 issue, Jean Valentino is interviewed and again states that Valentino was not a homosexual. The Valentino spokeswoman, Janine Villalobos, also confirmed this on several occasions, once in a conversation with an LA Times reporter. This has also been confirmed by Kika Guglielmi Marrone, a Valentino relative here in Turin, whose mother knew Valentino's sister well until her death. Now, moving on. Before Valentino left Italy, he could not go to say goodbye to his brother because he had to go to Turin to see his beloved prima donna. And I cite, in reference to this time in his life, all of our research presented about the circumstances of his leaving Italy leading to the premise that Jean could have been his love child, which we reveal in Affairs Valentino. Now, in the Directville biography, she cites a possible second love child of Valentino's, and I quote, "Robert Teldy Name, a man of letters and a playwright, who was formerly a variety show manager and a film producer. He knew Pola Negri well. Now, in 1932, he obtained for her an engagement with the Olympia Theater in Paris. In 1934, he set up an appearance for her on a Marseille stage where she did a singing tour with Jean Trochant and Orbifone Records. He reported that Pola said that Rudolph Valentino was very passionate and that he responded to her own ardor. And I think I can tell you that she said Rudy had a son. This is how this happened. One evening, I was in Pola's dressing room before the curtain rose. Someone knocked. He was a handsome young man of dark skin who introduced himself by saying, 'Excuse me for disturbing you, madam, but I wanted to tell you that I am the son of Rudolph Valentino. I never revealed my identity before because my mother is of mixed blood, and I know the Americans do not like that much. My father, Rudolph, became an American citizen, and I call myself Audrey Hurst,'" end quote. Now, moving on in this body of historical knowledge, in New York City, Valentino engaged in an open involvement in love affair with New York socialite Blanca de Salles, and later told various people she was the great love of his life, including his brother, Alberto. Valentino's friend, the actor and director Douglas Girard, who sponsored him during his earliest days in Hollywood, shared stories about Valentino's girlfriends and women in his life, and one story which reveals how both he and Rudolph had a crush on the same woman, actress Mary Miles Minter. Paul Ivano, friend and cameraman, who lived in the Sunset Boulevard bungalow with Valentino and Natasha Rombova. He relates an account of seeing a nude Valentino rushing from making love to Natasha to ask Ivano for help because she passed out. Now, this account is shared in Michael Morris's biography of Rombova titled Madame Valentino. Manuel Ricci, attaché for the Mexican consulate and husband of Valentino's co-star in both the Chic movies. He was a well-known playboy and womanizer. He organized dinners and parties during the trip with Valentino to London and Paris in December of 1925 and into 1926. Pola Negri slept with Valentino in the Falcon Lair master bedroom, leaving her lingerie there. After Valentino's death, Falcon Lair handyman Lou Mahoney took Negri's privates home for his wife, who sewed them into fancy dresses for their daughter. Now, George Ullman, Valentino's close friend and trusted business manager, witnessed Valentino engaging in a passionate kiss with Mae Murray and driving off, leaving him standing in the parking lot of the American Legion Arena. George Ullman was also witness to Rudolph and Natasha's sleeping arrangements on the mineral lava train and in both of the Valentino's homes. On the one occasion he intervened in an argument between the two, he writes how he told Rudy to sleep downstairs and not get back into bed with Natasha until things had cooled off. Valentino ignored that advice. And in a letter included in The True Rudolph Valentino by Balthasar Fernandez Cue, Natasha writes from her exile in Fox Lair, in which she pleads to be able to return to her husband in Los Angeles, and she signs the letter to Valentino as, quote, your naughty little doll, end quote. Collector Bill Self told me that everyone he interviewed who knew Rudy said this was not his truth. He was not gay. And this included Gene Acker. Makeup artist Mont Westmore recalls the occasion when he was on Valentino's yacht with Valentino and his co-star in Blood and Sand and Cobra, Nitta Naldi. Valentino asked Mont Westmore to take control of the boat so he could go below to the master bedroom and make love to Nitta. Westmore recalls the sounds of lovemaking and Nitta extolling Valentino's abilities. Now, in the letters written by Valentino to his first wife, Jean Acker, he pleads with her to sleep with him and be his wife in every sense of the word. And in the true Rudolph Valentino by Balthasar Cuay, we are provided with many scenarios and a great deal of first-hand accounts from the time frame just prior to Valentino leaving on his fatal trip east, such as on page 102, and I quote, Rudolph was again fully living the bachelor life, and the public often witnessed the accompaniment of a lady actress he might be dating. But the women who would truly gain his attention were, of course, the ones the public did not see. There was one woman one day and another the next, countless women who disputed the honor of being intimate with him. Whether in Hollywood or in the surrounding area, in his house or in the ladies' homes or his friends' homes, in hotel rooms and cabarets, in his yacht of such sad history, here these affairs took place to fill him with joy. End quote. Balthasar Cuay witnessed Pola Negri in Falcon Lair with Valentino during the last weeks of Valentino's life in Los Angeles. And Pola Negri herself, in her autobiography, Memoir of a Star, writes in detail about her physical relationship with Valentino. But without a doubt, some of the most extensive research on this subject was conducted by French Valentino biographer Jean de Recqueville. She contacted many people who were then still alive who knew Rudolph Valentino, René Clair, Robert Flory, Jacques Hiberteau, and all said the entire belief that Rudolph Valentino was gay was just a way to exploit his sexuality to make money. Now, she had access, by the way, Renato, to the French archives of André Davin, and I will say those letters are most fascinating. Now, I'm going to add to this impressive body of criteria, this historical knowledge as to Rudolph Valentino's sexual orientation, by adding two of his own declarations. The first is the last line of a letter written by Rudolph Valentino, which is included in the Cuay book. And I quote, Valentino writes, however, I must admit that I am never indifferent to the attraction of the beautiful sex, end quote. And also one of his more notable quotes, where he says, quote, I like my women all good or all bad, but mostly all good, end quote. So as to those people long ago who shared their histories and in doing so created this body of knowledge about this subject, the people in Rudolph Valentino's daily life who knew him well, I found them to be open-minded, modern for their day, and sophisticated. I did not find them to be bigoted, but I will say they were angry about this misrepresentation of Valentino because it was not his truth, and because the motive in making him gay was so blatantly and commercially inspired. Now, despite all of this, and much, much more, David Brett, Simon Constable, and Tracy Terhune claim to know more. They would have us believe that all of these respected individuals and Valentino's life conspired to misrepresent him, claiming they were, and I quote, snakes, liars, shysters, child kidnappers, crooks, and thieves. But I ask, are we to believe that all of these distinguished, professional, and intelligent people were for some reason conspiring in unison to hide that Rudolph Valentino was gay? And are we to believe seriously that somehow such a conspiracy was perpetuated over the ensuing decades? How can this ever be taken seriously by anyone?
You have a letter you received some time ago. You want to cite.
I do. Yes, I do. Because it was an articulate way to frame this. And I quote from a letter forwarded to me sometime, probably the end of 2010, from a Dr. Greenberg, who received it from one of his clients, a gay man who signed the letter as David T. Now, David T. writes Dr. Greenberg, revealing how he was upset after reading some of what David Brett was posting about me at the time, and I quote, "Calling a person a homophobe does not mean they are any more that than labeling them homosexuals means they are gay. When will this gentleman, parentheses, and just because I call him that does not mean he is, when will he stop basing everything he writes on hearsay, rumor, and outright lie? This man and his ilk, Kenneth Anger comes to mind, should not be allowed to perpetuate these gay myths about people in such damaging terms," end quote. Thank you, David T., whoever you are, and to Dr. Greenberg, who forwarded that letter to my Affairs Valentino website, because damaging is the word. The damaging appropriation of homosexuality to misrepresent Valentino's history in such a self-serving and intellectually dishonest way should not be tolerated, especially, I think, among the LGBT plus community. I believe, though, within the Rudolph Valentino community and on those Valentino Facebook forums they control, this behavior is tolerated to a great extent out of fear. Because if you say someone was not gay, if you dissent, you are by default accused of being homophobic. Yes, it is Gay Pride Month, a time of celebration. Love is love. And in this spirit, I dedicate this episode to my friend Roger and my friend Wayne, who both defended me so passionately before their demise. And I will add here my friend Judy Chastain, who is also deceased, but fought the fight with me years ago. She used to call herself the greatest lesbian of all time. And when she wrote Brett, he savaged her, as we expected he would. These people were my family, who loved me and cared for me and mine. So imagine how it has felt to have my reputation destroyed by the word homophobic and by the likes of David Brett. I will never just stand by silently in the face of this abuse by David Brett, by Simon Constable, and by Tracy Terhune, who churn out hate on a blog designated to hating me and to you, Renato, and who engage in damaging, divisive, cruel rhetoric and bullying. This while they accuse everyone else of having an agenda, when in fact they are the only ones that do, and it is glaring, and it always has been. And I have to add here as an aside, personally, that I have not known many actual homophobic people. Maybe none. Why would I? I would not consider them friends or people I could remotely relate to. But somehow in my quest to oppose this damaging homophobic fiction from being wielded as a controlling weapon and so frivolously to, as Tracy Terhune calls it, to wonderfully debunk my work and to purposely divide the Valentino world in the process, for this I have come to be known as homophobic. I expose their racket, their censorship, their intimidating ways, and in this I consider them not so unlike the Inquisition. They are fundamentalists who demand adherence to their own rigid doctrine, extending no hand of tolerance and skulking about it in open display of their medieval and absolute refusal to accept the factual data, the research discoveries, first-hand source material, and the accounts of those in Rudolph Valentino's daily life. For them, the world is still flat as a pancake. They act out, and so confidently, upon their authoritative lies, and do not contribute to the dialogue, to any harmonious exchange, but instead they diminish it, driving people away from the subject of Valentino at all. I know this because many of these people have contacted me. Rudolph Valentino is not gay and not bisexual, and I support that statement today by referencing all the data I could find. And I will say this, that available data was not meager. And I found Valentino's sexual orientation to be remarkably unambiguous. I will never dismiss the serious accounts of those who were there and knew. George Ullman, Douglas Girard, Gene Acker, Pola Negri, Bill Self, Alberto Valentino, Gene Valentino, Janine Villalobos, Kika Guglielmi Morone, René Clair, Jacques Ibertot, Robert Flory, Paul Ivanov, and the list goes on and on. How the relentless campaign to make Valentino gay or bisexual by Tracy Trehune, David Brett, and Simon Constable is but a colossal contrivance inspired by trash books about Valentino and heavily promoted by David Brett and by the censor Tracy Trehune. After 20 years of my waiting for documentation, there has been none brought forth to support their ludicrous corruption of Valentino's truth. And in regards to so many aspects of his life story which have fallen victim to their scam. And I think by now the thrill of pulling this off has, in my opinion, surpassed any ability for them to stop it. It seems to be a hilarious prank, which they, and especially David Brett, like to claim has been profitable. In this, they sorely underestimate Rudolph Valentino's fans and the Valentino aficionados and scholars. Not all are fooled by their so-called expertise. Some people and many who communicate with me are brilliantly astute and knowledgeable, utterly aware that this is total BS. I have known it for quite a while. Rudolph Valentino himself once said, and I quote, "Gossip, it's never related in the same way. When you eat hash, you do not always recognize the different kinds of meat in it, do you? So it is with twice told tales," end quote. So in this episode, I've established the necessity for historical criteria as required by the Gay Hall of Fame to include or not to include someone on their list of gay icons. In this case, Valentino is not to be included and was removed, citing, first of all, the personal statements attributed to him, and secondly, the exceptional body of history credited to Valentino about his true sexual orientation, as shared by his family and everyone else who ever knew him.
For today, I want to tell listeners to check out all of our books on Amazon, and especially our latest book, which you have cited earlier, The True Rudolph Valentino by Baltasar Fernandez Quer, a book I translated from Spanish to English.
Yes, the book Rudolph Valentino began working on in his final weeks in Los Angeles, a collaboration with Baltasar Cuey. After Valentino's death, Cuey would publish the book as a 10-part series in the Spanish movie fan magazine Cine Mundial. So thank you, Renato, for your work making it available to an English-speaking audience for the first time. And you can find that in all of our books, as Renato said, on Amazon. I want to thank everyone who supports our work, who contribute to these podcasts, who write and share such fascinating discussions. You are each so appreciated and valued. Thank you.
And as always, I say, fiat justitia, ruat caelum. And for the good guys, arrivederci.